are going where few people are allowed to go, where tons of containers are loaded and unloaded every day, behind the scenes at the port of Savannah. Body diagrams help people like shippers, builders, engineers, and architects visualize the forces in play. Today, we're going to show you how to draw them. So let's get started. First, you'll have to know that there are all kinds of forces all around us. In this section, we'll focus on gravity, the normal force, tension, applied force, and friction. Which forces are acting on all objects, like these giant containers? On a free body diagram, you will draw the forces acting on an object, like this big container. It's just sitting on the ground. So what are the forces and how do you show them? To represent the container, you simply draw a square and put a dot in the center. In this course, the dot will always go in the center of the object. Now keep in mind, forces are a vector quantity. So they're written as arrows that have a magnitude and direction. When you're drawing these forces, only draw forces that are acting directly on the object, and draw all of them from the dot at the center. Okay, looking at our list, what forces are acting on this container? Gravity is one, right? Everything on Earth has gravity pulling it down toward the center of the Earth. So that vector points down, always perpendicular to the ground. You write that F sub G for gravity, and you draw an arrow pointing down. The direction of the arrow represents the direction of the force, and the length of the arrow represents the magnitude of the force. Okay, so what are other forces acting on the container? Anytime the object is resting on a surface, you have normal force pushing up on the object. It's perpendicular to the surface. So draw an arrow up. That's F sub N for normal force. Now, how do you know whether these arrows are the same length? And how much do each of these forces exert on the object? Remember, vectors are magnitudes of the quantity in a certain direction. The magnitude is the length of the arrow in a certain direction. So here's how to figure out if one force is greater than another. If the object is motionless, the net force is zero. So these arrows are going to be the same length. You put a little line, a little hash across each to show they're equal to each other in magnitude. What forces are in play when I'm pushing a box and it's gaining speed as I move it? By pushing the box, I'm applying a different force, appropriately called applied force. The symbol for that is F sub APP. How do you draw a free body diagram of the forces at work here? Again, draw your box, put your dot in the center. What forces are acting on the box? There's gravity, pulling the box down, and the normal force acting up from the surface. Do you know how long the arrows should be? To figure it out, look at the y-axis and ask yourself, are there any forces accelerating in the y direction? If not, the forces are equal in magnitude, so the arrows should be the same length. Next, look at the forces acting on the box in the x direction. There is acceleration due to the applied force, right? On your free body diagram, you draw applied force with the arrow going from the center of the box in the direction of the force. And there's another force at work as well, between the floor and the box. Do you know what force that is? Here's a hint. What's this force? The force is friction. When two objects come in contact with each other, friction acts opposite to the direction of motion. You write friction F sub lowercase f. In the case of the moving box, it's kinetic friction. Kinetic because at least one of the objects is moving. Here's how you show it on your diagram. If the box is moving to the left, then we know friction moves to the right because friction always opposes motion. In this case, the applied force arrow is longer than the friction arrow. Why? Because we said earlier that the box was speeding up. An object will always accelerate in the direction of the net force. Even though friction is opposing the motion, acting to the right, the applied force, acting to the left, will have a larger arrow than friction because we're speeding up. Now, what if the box is slowing down? The frictional force would be greater and the arrow would be longer than the applied force arrow. What if the frictional force and the applied force are the same? The box would either be at rest or it would be moving at a constant velocity and the arrows would be the same length. Okay, here's another one for you. A container suspended by a crane. What forces are in play here? Gravity, of course. Do we have a normal force? No, because it's not resting on a surface, but it is suspended by a rope. What type of force is keeping our object up? Tension. The force along a string, rope, or a chain. The tension symbol is F sub T. So how do you draw this? The object isn't moving, so the net force is zero. Since the net force is zero, there must be another force acting on the box. Any guesses? Even though it's suspended, gravity, in the form of weight, is still working on the container. So the downward force is weight, with a downward arrow equal to the length of the arrow for tension, and marked with an F sub W. So the force moving up is equal to the force down. Vectors are equal and balanced. Now that you know how to do free body diagrams, look around you and test your ability to figure out what forces are in play and how they interact. That's physics in motion. And for more practice, check out the Closer Look on Free Body Diagrams.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.